They watched events happening and they interpreted them. But the interpretation was not of predetermined. It wasn't determinism. It was seeing forces at work in which good and evil, when Israel chose to be unjust, then that you could, the prophet would say, if you go that way, it will lead to loss of life and destruction. You will be able to go to exile, you will lose the land, or whatever it was. If you return to God, the events will change. So it was not determined, it was always open-ended, but around an instinctive, prophetic instinct that listened to God and said, if we walk in God's way, this is how it will work. If we go another way, this is how it's going to work.
I agree with you that if you are imprisoned with the word and you want to put the words together to form a map, you can be misguided and mistaken. I agree with you entirely because our Prophet, Allah's blessings be upon him, has described the world of the Antichrist as one in which appearance and reality are completely opposite to each other. And he said, beware of the last age, because there will be great liars, people telling monstrous lies, so that appearance and reality are opposite to each other. Things are not what they appear to be. And he had a prayer, a lovely prayer. He said, O Allah, show me things as they are, in parenthesis, that I might not be deceived by what they appear to be. It is not the external form of the words, but the internal reality. And we need, therefore, an epistemology to deal with an age of awesome deception. The Quran speaks with almost the same words as the Bible. If I'm wrong, you can correct me. The Quran says that there are people who have eyes and yet they do not see. He's shaking his head already. It's there in the Bible. They have ears and yet they do not hear. They have hearts and yet they do not understand. And now comes this very famous statement concerning the Antichrist, about which we are still fighting in Islam. Dajjal sees with his left eye, he is blind in the right eye, it looks like a bulging grape, but your Lord is not one eye. We have people who are waiting for one-eyed man. It wasn't Nelson, Lord Nelson. It wasn't Nelson.
You're blaming on me.
It wasn't Moshe Dayan. Moshe Dayan was a great general. Because they interpreted literally. We on this side of the fence in Islam, who recognize this as religious symbolism, we say no, this is an epistemological problem. The left eye symbolizes external sight and therefore knowledge externally acquired. The blind right eye symbolizes internal blindness and therefore an incapacity to receive knowledge internally. Thank you.
Christianity, Judaism, Hinduism, Buddhism, Islam, they all have this common belief that there is continuous conflict between truth and falsehood. But that there will come a final triumph of truth over falsehood. And that final triumph of truth over falsehood would herald the end of history. We turn now to modern Western civilization and their view concerning the movement of history and the end of history. What conception do they have of the movement of history? What is their conception of truth? And what is their differing conceptions of the end of history? I tell you, this is a truly fascinating subject. This is the civilization which has an obsession with the Holy Land. They may not say it, but they also believe that history is going to end with events which will unfold in the Holy Land, as the Christians do, as the Jewish do. Modern Western civilization has displayed its obsession with the Holy Land in many instances in history. Western civilization, what is its conception of the movement of history? What is its conception of the end of history?